Trying to remember what we used to do. Let's do that again. My dearly beloved sisters and brothers, I welcome us to this morning's live streamed online and in the flesh service of the Holy Eucharist here at St. Matthew's Episcopal Church, Spartanburg, South Carolina, on this fourth Sunday of the season of Advent, December 19th in the year 2021.
The Lord be with you. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for the gift of
My beloved, please stand and let us say together, all loving God, fill our hearts with your love, and as you revealed to us by an angel the coming of your Son as man, so lead us through his suffering and death to the glory of his resurrection. We pray for this in the name of Jesus. Amen. And now our processional hymn, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. With you
and also with you.
Let us pray. Purify our conscience, Almighty God, by your daily visitation, that your Son Jesus Christ at his coming
may find in us a mansion prepared for himself, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
No matter how small or insignificant a person, an interaction, an event, or a place, the possibility of a world-changing effect is always present. Approach your life with appropriate wonder, especially in its small moments. A reading from the book of the prophet Malachi. You, O Israel of Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule Israel, whose origin is of old, from ancient days. Therefore you shall give them up, therefore he shall give them up until the time when she is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel. And he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the Lord his God. And they shall live secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now let's read in unison Psalm 80, which is found in your service sheet. Hear, O shepherd,
Of Israel, leading Joseph like a flock. Shine forth, you that are enthroned upon the cherubim, in the presence of Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh. Stir up your strength and come to help us. Restore us, O God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angered, despite the prayers of your people? You have fed them with the bread of tears. You have given them bowls of tears to drink. You have made us the derision of our neighbors, and our enemies laugh us to scorn. Restore us, O God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
For true freedom, choosing to do the will of God is a sacrifice. It is the only choice that ends its journey in eternal life. A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. When Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure." Then I said, "See, God, I've come to do your will. O God, in the scroll of the book it is written of me." When he said above, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in the sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings. These were offered according to the law." Then he added, "See, I've come to do your will." He abolishes the first in order to establish the second. And it is by God's will that we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely, from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promises he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and his descendants forever." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
This day I'm privileged to preach out of the righteous heart of Mary, in the name of her Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
O come, O come, Emmanuel, we sing. Thus giving melodic voice to the meaning of Advent, this season of Christian anticipation of the Advent, the coming birth of Jesus, our Emmanuel, the word literally meaning God with us. Still, as an inveterate question asker, I ask, do we always want God with us? I'm talking God, infinite mystery and infinite majesty. God, whose thoughts, Isaiah declares, are higher than ours, thus never like ours. God, whose judgments and ways, the Apostle Paul testifies, are unsearchable and inscrutable. I'm talking God. God, who therefore is never completely comprehensible and never controllable. I'm talking God. Therefore, the one who always inspires our reverence and our fear. I know. I've heard so many preachers and teachers will say, you know, whenever you see in the Bible when it says fear the Lord, it means have reverence, friends. It also means be scared. Epistle to the Hebrews, it occurs to me, it is a fearsome thing to fall into the hands of a living God. See, if God is dead, it's not a fearsome thing. But if God is alive, it's a fearsome thing to fall into the hands of a living God. I'm talking God this morning. Amen? Amen. Amen. Okay. So, I'm going to suggest something else to you this morning. Maybe it's better to keep God at arm's length. You know, on occasion, at least once a week on Sunday, give God the courtesy of a passing nod. You know, like Voltaire, who reputedly said, God and I acknowledge each other, but we're really never quite on speaking terms. But maybe that's just a bit too cavalier and too sacrilegious for some, if not all of us. So, friends, on a more serious note, as we stand here on the threshold of our Christmas celebration, maybe it's safer, saner for us to keep God small. O come, Emmanuel, and stay as that Bethlehem baby, born to an unwed teenage mother, betrothed to a common village carpenter. Stay in that cold, dark stable. Stay in that manger, a feeding trough for animals. Stay harmless and non-threatening. But you and I know that won't work. For Emmanuel, God with us, Jesus grew up. And Jesus grew up and launched a ministry. I digress. You know the wonderful thing about preaching is I bi-weekly, get to remind you of what you already know. You remember that wonderful fourth chapter in the Gospel according to Luke, where Jesus went into a synagogue to inaugurate his ministry. And per the custom of the synagogue, he took the scroll from the attendant and read those words of Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And the Spirit has anointed me to bring good news to whom? The poor. To open the eyes of the blind. To set the captives free. To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And then also per the custom, Jesus gave the scroll back to the attendant and sat down. Because that's the way you preached, you sat down. And I don't know when we got to stand up. Because back in the day, preachers sat down to preach. And let us not forget what Jesus said after he read that Isaiah text. He said, today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. And then, what did Jesus do? In the name of God, he went out and caused a ruckus, reaching out to all, reaching across ancient cultural barriers between rich and poor,
righteous and sinner, well and sick, living and dead, men and women, old and young, Jew and Gentile. Therefore, breaching sacred lines of division meant to keep the peace by keeping everyone in their place. Jesus violated all of it. And the love and justice of God reaching out to everyone always. But what else would Jesus do? According to our gospel text this morning, his advent, his coming was signaled by his cousin John, who still in his mother Elizabeth's womb leapt for joy at the sound of Mary's voice, leading Mary to burst into song. And what did she sing? It was no sweet lullaby. It was a righteous rant. It was a radical manifesto of what God would do, of what God already had set in motion with Jesus' conception. And again, as an inveterate question asker, I wonder, how often did Mary sing that song after Jesus was born? How often did she sing that song as she taught him the story of their people? A story, a history, a difficult history, with periods of blessed liberty and wretched captivity. How often did she sing that song when she taught him about God? I'm talking God, who through it all sustained the people, come what may. And God, who through an angelic vision came to her and foretold a time of deliverance through him. Oh, you got to know Mary sang. Come on. Mary, did you know? Yes, she knew. No wonder, brothers and sisters, Jesus grew up and did what he did. And what he did was fulfill Mary's song, thus becoming, being a problem. Yeah, I know we talk about Jesus is our Lord. Yeah, that's true. Jesus is our Savior. Yeah, that's true. Jesus is the Son of God. Yeah, that's true. Jesus is the Messiah. Yeah, that's true. Jesus is our friend and brother. Yeah, that's true. Jesus is a problem. For Jesus, in his life and ministry, so disturbed the principalities and powers of the world, both political and religious, who were threatened by his radical hospitality and his equality, so they killed him. Looking at our world as it was and still is, not much has changed. The powerful and the prosperous remain powerful and prosperous. And thus we might dismiss Mary's song as wishful, delusional thinking, especially when we translate it into modern terms of the elimination of class distinctions and the redistribution of economic resources. That's what she's talking about.
So you thought this was a lullaby? Ha! But we can't. We can't dismiss the song. We can't dismiss Mary. Because again, her song took flesh in Jesus, our Emmanuel, our God with us, who therefore is a greater problem. For Jesus, as then so now, disturbs the world's value system. You see, my beloved, Mary's song doesn't condemn the mighty and the rich, but rather she testifies that power and wealth, either, often both, almost always the currency of exchange in human societies. Power and wealth are not eternally valuable. They are of this world. And they have no standing in the righteous sight of God. What matters to God? Mary tells us. Jesus shows us. Humility, mercy, service, self-sacrifice. That's what matters to God. And therefore, Jesus is our greatest problem. For Jesus disturbs how we live. And I'm about to close. When we sing, O come, Emmanuel, we are calling ourselves to continue Jesus' ministry. We are to be radically hospitable. We are to be wedded to radical equality. And let me just suggest, at least for myself, what that means. Whenever, wherever, however we can, we are to level life's playing field. We are to bring down the powerful. We are to lift up the lowly. We are to fill the hungry who have nothing with good things, and we are to send the rich who already have more than enough away empty. I didn't say take from them what they had, but don't give any more, because they already have enough. What Jesus does, we are to do. I close. Christianity, if it's nothing else, is an incarnational religion. From the Latin, in carne, in flesh. Christianity is the story, if nothing else, of a transcendent God who took flesh in Jesus so to become immanent in time and space, and who through the Spirit becomes flesh in who? Us. So when we sing, O come, Emmanuel, what we're really singing is, O come, you and me, to do what Jesus not did, but does through us. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. My beloved, please stand and let us recite in unison the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God,
the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man.
For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried.
On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures.
He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified.
He has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
I ask for your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for Andrew, our bishop, for his gathering, and for all ministers and people. Pray for the church. I ask for your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace. I ask for the prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask for your prayers for all who seek God, for a deeper knowledge of him. Pray that they may find and be found by him. I ask your prayers for the departed. Pray for those who have died. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day. And now let us say together the prayer for spiritual growth. Gracious Father, we ask spiritual growth for ourselves, our families and friends, and especially for our family, St. Matthew's. Grant us growth and understanding and willingness to be your body in this world. Empower us to live the mission of Christ, to preach, teach, heal, and make disciples. In joyful thanksgiving for the blessing of your presence in our lives, compel us to share you with everyone we meet. May your numbers increase, our community deepen, our lives be joyfully yours. Make us a God-centered people. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
We confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We are, in a sense, in a return to normalcy, and yet, as we gather, we need to acknowledge that the Omicron variant is now spreading in our state. So I urge everyone to be careful. If you wish to mask, please do. We wish to everyone to be with us, to worship, but we also, more than anything, want everyone to be safe. As of now, I only know of two members of the parish that currently have COVID and they are recovering, but I do ask for continued prayers for everyone who suffers from this pandemic and all of our medical folks who are indeed, whether they are on the floor or even in the offices of our facilities, they are indeed on the front lines. It is wonderful to see so many people here. It's a real blessing to see faces that we haven't seen that often. We will be here every opportunity that we have, which means tonight our youth lock-in. There will be quite a crowd present. That means at 5:00 today we will gather in the parking lot for carols and hot chocolate. And this coming week, we will, of course, gather on Wednesday night and then on Christmas Eve at 5 and 11. Christmas Day will be live streamed from my home. And then on the Sunday after Christmas, we will be back together again. I'm telling you this in the middle of the service so you can go ahead and make plans to do nothing else but come to church this week. Again, thank you. Thank you so much to our wonderful choir, our organist choir master, for the beautiful music today. Father Paul, an extraordinary sermon, a powerful sermon. And of course, to our video team that makes all of this possible. And a special thank you to Kathy McCart. I love what she did on the altar flowers, which the greenery and the berries. It's beautiful. Thank you. All of this is possible because of your generosity, because of your extraordinary stewardship. We've been able to keep, as you know, the food pantry going basically the entire time, the preschool, all of our ministries, because of your extraordinary stewardship. So thank you. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts with thanksgiving. Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, and your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days, you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with our patron Matthew, the Blessed Virgin Mary, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. And feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. Please open your prayer books to the inside front cover. Read. We send you out to share communion this week with Sarita Shipman. May you carry the prayers of all of us as you take this sacrament of Christ's presence. May those who receive it from you be strengthened and encouraged in that community we have together in our Lord Jesus Christ. In the healing name of Jesus, and with the compassionate embrace of the family of St. Matthew's, we send you forth bearing these holy gifts of our Lord's spiritual body and blood, that those to whom you go may experience with us the majesty and the mystery of his presence through the sharing of the wafer and the cup. May the one bread and the one wine call us into the binding awareness of our unity. Nothing, whether it be distance, illness, or age, can ever separate us from the knowledge of our personal worth and our oneness in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each of you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. I've done something I don't normally do. I pulled out my phone. I did it to check the weather. Tonight at 5 o'clock, we have a 0% chance of rain. And so it was going to be a little damp singing in the parking lot otherwise. But we're looking forward to having as many folks come out as possible. Join us. Perhaps our neighbors will join us, perhaps they won't, but it's our opportunity to get together and be very, very un-Episcopal and sing Christmas carols before Christmas Eve. So come out, join us, have fun. It should be a wonderful, wonderful time. I didn't say this at the piece because I did not want in any way to reflect on Father Paul's sermon. But I do have an answer to one of the questions that he raised, okay? And that's that we now preach standing up, okay? Because if not, he would be mute. Announcements.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Caitlin Roberts. I'm the Director of Christian Formation here at St. Matthew's. We do offer formation classes for all ages immediately following this service in our education building. For this month, for Advent, we are doing a curriculum for adults called the Poetry of Advent, which is a devotional inspired by the poetry of Mary Oliver and also follows along with each week of Advent and the gospel readings from that as well. There are some printed copies in that classroom in the adult, in the library/conference room if you have not been yet and would like to join. There are also copies of the poems that you'll be discussing this week. And there's also links to digital copies as well in your email you should have gotten this week, a link to the curriculum and a link to the poetry as well. We have pageant practice, of course, tonight as well, but it's going to be a little later. It's going to start around 5:45 because we have our carols for the community, our carols and cocoa. And we will have our dress rehearsal on Thursday, December 23rd at 6 p.m. Let's see. You talked about our Advent services. I will mention for grace that we still have the reverse Advent calendar going on. If you would like to bring it, you can. If you can still keep collecting if you haven't started yet. There are lists of items to collect, but basically this is just a nice little practice to do for Advent rather than having your own little Advent calendar with candy where you take something out for yourself, you put something in for somebody else. There's an item for each day of Advent. When you've collected all your items, bring that box in on December 26th to be blessed and given to the food pantry to replenish them because they really get wiped out during this season. And there's some items in the narthex you can take a look at. It's a really easy collection of items to put together. I think Grace got everything for maybe under $30. So if you have any questions about that, you can see Grace. Thank you.
Folks, I had someone last night asking, they're going to be out of town for the holiday, if it would be okay to turn in their reverse Advent giving later when they get back. Absolutely, of course. Because we're addressing hunger in our community, and it doesn't go away. But because of y'all and your extraordinary efforts, folks are fed throughout the year. We're about reading about 10,000 folks a year because of y'all's generosity. And I want to say a very, very specific thank you to Hallie Price. Hallie is with BMW, and as I understand it, we're the only charity in Spartanburg County. We're one of the only ones in Spartanburg County that receives the hams and turkeys from BMW for distribution. We gave them out this past Wednesday. Hallie, thank you so much. I know you have to. I'm sure she pesters the folks up the line in a loving Christian way, but I know it takes a lot of work on your part, so thank you very, very much. Normally, we would have our December vestry meeting this Tuesday. We are not going to gather on Tuesday. It's the week of Christmas. There are lots of things going on. So for our new members of the vestry, you'll be gathering with us in January. We're doing sort of a reorganization around the spiritual gifts that Martin Darby has helped us recognize in ourselves. And so that will be the time to launch that new way of functioning as a vestry, addressing the gifts and talents that each and every one of y'all have. So God bless our vestry. Thank you for your extraordinary service for those that are rotating off. And I look forward to seeing everyone at vestry after the first of the year. And what time are we gathering tonight? For the lock-in? 5. Very good. Yes, sir?
Just one final announcement.
Uh-huh.
Brother Mark, I want to thank you for rendering so beautifully, "Let all mortal flesh keep silence," and praise God that your mortal flesh did not keep silent. It is your birthday. And as you often not sing to us, you sing with us. You give voice the way we would love to be able to do if we but could. And so we praise God for that. And happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, dear Mark.
Happy birthday to you. Other announcements. Father Paul.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.